Samuel Leeds, we're looking at a deep dive discussion today into commercial property. So I brought on my good friend, Mr. James Sinclair. James, welcome to the show.
Hey Sam, how you doing, mate? Good to be here.
Good to have you here.
Yeah.
You're an entrepreneur.
Yeah, that's mainly what I am. But yeah. I like property too, and I love what you're doing, so I was really keen to be on here with you.
I wanted to bring you on this discussion because you're an entrepreneur, you make a lot of money, you've invested in residential property.
Yeah.
You've also invested heavily into commercial property.
Yeah.
So I thought it'd be really good to get kind of a pros and cons of commercial versus residential. Also understanding of what is commercial property.
Yeah.
But before we do any of that, why don't you just give a little bit of an introduction to yourself and explain where you are and where you're coming from.
So first of all, started off like you're doing kids' parties.
Yeah, well, and that is my background.
Magician, yeah.
I did it for a few months, you did it for a very...
You would not believe how many people in this industry started off doing kids' parties.
Really?
It's weird, what, all magicians.
In the property industry or the training industry?
In the training business speakers. Well, yeah, I suppose it makes sense.
Simon Zushi? He was an entertainer.
Was he really?
He was a magician.
Yeah, so even the Wolf of Wall Street, Jordan Belfort, you know that guy, started off doing kids' parties.
Well, there we go.
There we go. So basically, I started off doing that. I built that business up. I started buying property residential when I was 18, 19, and I rented that out. Then I remortgaged that to build what I would call a traditional brick and mortar business. I built a children's family entertainment centre, and I started building day nurseries, and then... That, bless you. Then open a theme park and a farm zoo park, and that business grows today. We've got 400 staff, do about £1 million a month in sales, and that continues to run. And I had some spare time. I went into schools, start teaching business and entrepreneurship, wrote a couple of books, and you really have got a little coldy woldy there,
aren't
you? And so then I started thinking. I looked at people that were doing really well in property, and I realised the people that were really super wealthy didn't have flats and houses. They had office blocks and commercial property. But I also realised that it's a much higher barrier to entry. Like, I at 19 couldn't have gone and bought, you know, an office block or a warehouse to rent out. You know, it's much harder to get the mortgages on them and et cetera, et cetera. But I think over the long term, there's more money to be made out of commercial.
Okay. Yeah, interesting. I would agree with that. I mean... Yeah. When I speak to people like Lord Sugar about property, he is into property in a very, very big way, and he only does commercial.
Yeah.
But then, if that had been the way forward, the best way forward, I'd have never got into property because there's no way. I mean, I do commercial now, but starting out, where do you start?
Or the caveat to Alan Sugar as well, I believe it's business first, property second, because a business can generate so much cash flow if you get it right that you can then really grow your property empire. Lots of people think, you know, property then business, and or they spend so much time on their property stuff they're not looking at their business enough. And if you really build a business really successfully, it's so much tax efficient to get wealth out of that into property.
I guess it depends on what you're wanting to achieve. Like, if you're wanting to achieve serious wealth building, then I would agree the best strategy is to have a business that makes a lot of cash flow.
Yeah.
Dump that money strategically into property.
You got it.
That is the best way to make a lot of money.
Absolutely.
I think a lot of our viewers are starting with very little.
Yeah.
They might be working in a 9-to-5 job, really boring, and all they want to do is replace their income. Now, to replace their income, actually, to talk to them about set up a business and make you a load of cash flow and dump it into commercial. Actually, that's a completely different world.
So, funny thing is, Sam, do you know why I started out in property? So it was partly pension planning. I thought, you know, I was 18, bought my first one, and that would, you know, see me into the sunset when I got older. But I also went into property for the reason that I knew that I would buy in Essex, because I was from the southeast, sorry about that, from Essex. I would buy these and they would grow in value, and I'll be able to give them to the bank as security to borrow for the business, not to buy more property. And I knew that I wanted, you know, I start with the end in mind, I knew I wanted to own visitor attractions. I knew it was a capital intensive business. You know, when I was 16, I knew I wanted to own zoos and theme parks and stuff like that, because it's what I loved, you know, I was passionate about that stuff. But I knew that I needed lumps of capital to do that, and I thought, you know, be a magician first, learn the game, you know, it's a cash flow business, buy some property, grow the equity, give that to the bank to borrow to build the capital intensive business.
Yeah, that's really smart, and that's worked out really well for you.
And it has worked, but that's not for everyone, like you say.
What would you say then to somebody who, if someone was just starting out, and they were literally on £30,000 a year,
Yeah.
They had £30,000 in the bank.
Yeah.
They were working a job they hated.
Yeah.
Do you not think for that person, residential would not be a better way to get started than commercial would be?
So, regardless if it's residential or commercial, in that situation, I would be looking for high yielding assets, so good cash flow properties. So whether that would be, depends on where you are in the country. If you could buy a building for £100,000 and turned it into serviced offices, I think that would make more money than serviced accommodation in the residential world.
Okay.
But it depends where you are in the country. Like, that is impossible to do in Essex, impossible to do in London, Kent, and any of the home counties.
So is residential stuff.
Yeah,
so,
absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
So I would be looking at it on a deal basis. I'd be saying, right, I would want, a 20% ROI or at least on my money.
And you've been to my crash course, right?
Yeah, I understand. And that's the stuff that I would believe and that's what I would do.
Yeah.
I would try and look for it in commercial because that's what I know now. But back then when I didn't know, I would probably just go
for
houses.
So why don't we do a list then of pros to begin with as commercial? And then we'll perhaps look at some of the cons to commercial, some of the pros of residential, and then the viewers can make their own mind up.
Okay,
so
go for
you're
it.
Clearly very pro commercial generally.
Yeah.
So you go first and give me the biggest pro about commercial property.
So, not that it should be about this, but the government are not anti commercial landlords.
Yeah.
But I believe the establishment are anti residential landlords at the moment.
So, for instance, stamp duty is a lot cheaper.
Yeah, so lower stamp duty, the first 150,000, zero stamp duty. That's a huge pro.
Yeah.
You can claim all the interest back, all the costs back. None of that stuff has been affected.
But you can do that with residential when you're buying through a company.
Yes, of course, yeah. I suppose, so that's a massive pro. The yields are usually a lot higher.
Really?
Yeah.
Hold on as well. I was
give you an
to
give example.
One thing. Let me give one thing about commercial. I don't think the yields are higher.
I'll give you an example.
All right,
I'll prove
we'll
that
talk.
To you.
Yeah. I guess an advantage to commercial property would be that usually the tenants are better because they'll totally take responsibility of the whole building and property.
Yeah.
So rather than them bringing you and saying, the electricity's not working when really the light bulb needs changing, you wouldn't really get that.
Well, it depends. If you're doing serviced offices, then it's the same as doing serviced accommodation. You're responsible for the building.
Yeah, but I know, it depends on the commercial property.
Yeah.
But usually you can very easily have commercial properties. Some of the properties that we've got, you can just, you'll have a 10-year fixed contract and they'll do everything. Unless it's and you can just literally turn your back on it, forget about it.
Yep.
And it really is passive income in the best and purest sense. So I guess that's a good thing about commercial. One of the things that I don't like about commercial so much is that I think that it usually you need more money. Not always, but you don't see many, I don't anyway, maybe you disagree with me.
You need more money if you haven't got a trading business next to it. That's very important.
But a lot of people haven't though. So if you've just got £30,000 to invest, you're going to really, really struggle with commercial. And also,
Commercial in short form is for people that are business owners and in proper serious investors.
That's quite a big negative for certainly a lot of my viewers.
Absolutely it is, yeah.
How much would you say you need to invest in commercial property? I know it varies massively, but generally speaking.
So what I would say, first of all, the first commercial property anyone should buy is, if they was going to go into this world, and this does answer your question, if you've got a trading business and it was a fish and chip shop and you wanted to buy the building the fish and chip shop operates out of, if that's a profitable business, you should be able to get 100% finance from that just by going to a normal bank.
Is that not only for certain types of businesses though? Like if you're an accountant or something like that?
No. So basically you would, you would usually need bigger deposits for commercial property. That is also a negative. And
you need to put at least 40% in?
No, if it's an owner-managed business. So if you go back to our fish and chip shop scenario, I'm a fish and chip shop owner. My business is making £70,000 a year. If I could buy it, I don't want to put a deposit in, so I'd be going to the bank saying, look, I need to keep my money in the bank, but this makes commercial sense, it's going to improve my cash flow if I can buy it. You'll lend me 70%, the government will come in and do what we call an EFG loan, Enterprise Finance Guarantee Loan, and they will lend you the deposit. So it's like Help to Buy, but for commercial property.
Which is basically no money down.
No money down, but...
if you're going to be there.
Yeah. They won't do it for investment purposes, but that is a really smart thing to do. So if you're a doctor, if you're an accountant, yeah, although they've always done those sorts of deals. But like for your business, you could go up to your bank and they should give you an EFG loan because it's you're employing people and blah, blah, blah for the office that you're operating out on if you wanted to buy an office.
Yeah.
And what I would do, it'd be cheeky, buy an office that's too big and then rent out another couple of floors and, you know, then you sort of...
So if you're a trader and you have a business, that's a bit of a no-brainer
Absolutely.
Way to start to get your foot into the door.
Yeah.
And a lot of we've got a lot of our students that have got businesses and we've advised them to do things like that.
Where I think having just one little commercial... So if you was the fish and chip shop owner and you wanted to do more residential stuff, if you've got one business trading with a bank, you could then have a commercial bank manager that will look after you, that will help you do your residential property aspirations. And that's a little trick that I've definitely found that's helped me.
Brilliant. So are there any other big massive pros to commercial?
Another negative would be you always have to pay the capital down. So you get taxed on invisible income. Most mortgage lenders want the capital pay down on commercial, so you can't do interest only. So you're paying the capital down. That looks like a profit. You've got to pay tax on invisible income, I call it. I know it's not really, but you're paying tax on the capital that you're paying down.
Whereas residential, you can just wait for the property to go up in value.
Absolutely,
pay the absolute minimum.
But you, if you've got a trading cash flow in business, you could probably put that in the P&L of the trading business and that can be tax efficient. Another pro. I think the rents are much higher. That's why as well. So can I give you, just talk you through a deal.
Tell me the kind of return on investment you get from commercial property.
So I bought a property for $140,000 a few years ago and it rents for £35,000 a year.
Which is... okay, that's pretty high. Yeah. So what's that giving you?
I do basically a HMO for commercial. So I buy a warehouse, I put two units downstairs and three offices upstairs.
Yeah.
So then I derate it for council tax. I don't have council tax anymore because you get small business rates relief by separating the business. They're all up. So I never have to worry about business rates or council tax or anything like that. If one of my tenants go bust, I can put another one in. So basically, I've looked at the HMO model and go, I really like that. I like that that's a high yielding thing in the residential world. And I just stole that idea and put it into the commercial world.
That's fantastic. So how would you go about finding a commercial property like that?
So I think, I think it's finding the right locations because you want to choose where there's a... See, with residential, you can sort of... everyone wants to live anywhere with the residential thing in the UK. But I think it's much easier to do those in busy towns where there is business and trading going on.
Yeah.
But you still want to use your same ROI stuff. I've just bought a £900,000 warehouse. I completed on that yesterday. I put no money into it. Zero money into it.
So how did you structure that?
Well, the bank just went, I'll do it because it's my trading business. I'm the tenant of it.
Okay,
And you just, if you went up to the bank and said, I want to buy X property and I don't want to put any money into it, then they would say no.
So
if you're a trading business, it's that I just find if you're a trading business, you can do more in residential and everything. It's a really good thing for a property investor to have in your armory because you get to meet decent bank managers that can say, I understand what you're doing here, James. We can make a commercial decision on that. Call center banking can't do that.
What would you say then if somebody was not a businessman and they had, say, £100,000?
Yeah.
Would you think they'd be better off putting that into commercial or residential?
No, I still, even though I've said all this, I would still do residential first.
Yeah.
Because it's a step process. You know, like I told you, I wanted to own a visitor attraction. I knew that, first of all, I need to be a magician, learn how to deal with customers on a small scale, learn how to pay bills and invoice people, make that profitable. Then I'd done an events business. I hired out equipment. Then I'd done an indoor play centre. Then I'd done day nursery. Then I went for a farm park. Then we went for the theme park. There's a step process. And you don't want to cut things out and not learn the stuff.
And I think that, it's only in the recent months and years that we've started even doing commercial at all.
Yeah.
I think if I'd have started doing commercial 6-7 years ago, I'm glad I didn't.
Yeah, because when you're a business owner, you understand business and therefore you're going to be better at doing commercial property because it's mainly to businesses.
Yeah, but when you're just an investor, that's got some cash, and, I think personally, if you're an employee and you're wanting to get out of your job, I wouldn't even think about commercial.
No.
If you're a business person, And you've got cash coming in,
yeah,
then you definitely need to look at commercial.
What could be good though is if you've built up a series of residential property portfolio at year 10, so you've been doing that for 10 years,
yeah,
you could then say, right, I'm just going to buy one building now for £1 million, and that could, if you're smart, you could do self-storage in there, you could probably bring £250,000 a year off of that.
Yeah, yeah.
And you could put just one person running it, but those 10, and you could just probably remortgage and do that. So, I mean, like self-storage, I've got a client I work with that does storage, like that's hugely profitable and it's a good bolt onto it. So that could be, so you could say, right, I'll buy a warehouse, I do storage in there. So you've got a trading business, and then you could build a commercial property portfolio off of a trading business, and you can get like bank guarantees and stuff like that to build it up. That could be another way of doing it.
Yeah. There's not a lot of places where you can learn about commercial property. We focus on residential, certainly to begin with, unless you're very advanced.
So, yeah, the big problem is, but wherever it's a higher barrier to entry, there's more money to be made. Everything you do in life, the higher barrier to entry is, the more money to be made.
Yeah.
But it blocks people. So, you know, I'll give you an idea, like opening a theme park is probably one of the top things in leisure that makes money, but it's a much higher barrier to entry, and not everyone can open a theme park, for example, you know? So,
when I'm doing my financial freedom challenge next week, I'm going to be using strategies which require no money at all.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to be making even tens of thousands of pounds, let alone hundreds or millions.
I'm
going to be making hundreds of pounds and thousands of pounds.
That's right, yeah.
But I'm starting with nothing, which is very doable.
Yeah.
But then the other end of the spectrum is if you're making hundreds of thousands of pounds or you're making millions,
you don't want to
buy. Who wants to own like thousands of residential properties?
No, that's
nobody.
Right. No, that's right. You don't. But I just think sometimes when people like come into a business, they think, I could do this. That's low barrier to entry because they think they could do it. If you sit in, I don't know, a 2,000 bedroom hotel and you're sitting down in reception, you think, I'm going to open a hotel with 2,000 bedrooms. That doesn't go through many people's heads. But the person that does think like that, they're going to make so much money. And it's about thinking just a bit bigger than small thinking.
Yeah.
And you've got to, because someone's done it, haven't they?
Yeah.
So it is possible. You just got to say, no, I'm going to do that.
What advice would you give? You know my followers. How did you find the crash course, by the way?
Yeah, I think you're fantastic, mate. I actually love you a little bit. I think you're a really nice guy. I think you're honest and genuine. And I think, you know, we both teach people. I teach more about business and entrepreneurship. You teach about residential property. So it's slightly different, but our styles of being friendly and wanting to help people and passionate about that is very similar. And I'm drawn to people that care, and that's why I like you.
I really appreciate that.
In a straight way.
What advice would you say to my guys, my followers? You know their kind of situations usually.
Yeah.
What advice? What would you say the best piece of advice would be to them?
Stay teachable. Like I told you before we come on camera, stay teachable. Yeah, it's very dangerous if you build a bit of success. So maybe you've got 4 or 5 property deals in the bag and you think, yeah, I know this, I don't need to listen to anyone anymore. That is wrong.
Yeah.
And you know, you need to make sure that your mind can be changed by facts. Not by theory, by facts.
Yeah.
And that's why I like you as well, Samuel. That's why probably one of your greatest strengths that I've picked up, and I really try and make sure that I can stay having my mind changed by facts.
That's great. And James, one of the things I love about you is that you really have walked the walk. There's a lot of people out there that try and teach, and they have that they're only just doing it themselves.
And I've had the tough times as well. You know, it's not always been easy. You know, and I'm not. You know, it's been a process of 10 years. One of the things that another caveat to what could I teach people? Say, look, I think wealth takes 10 years to build serious wealth, and I think that's doing it at speed. I think you can bring cash flow wealth within 2 or 3 years, but real sustainable, like equity wealth worth, is a 10-year plan, and people need to remember that.
That's just realistic.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and sometimes people get the wrong idea when I teach financial freedom, and they're saying, you're saying that some of your students have done it in weeks.
Yeah.
I'm not talking they've become millionaires. I'm not talking they've created a big wealth pot. I'm talking they've replaced their income, and they're now either full-time in property, or they've got a small passive income of $2,000
Absolutely.
A month.
Yeah.
That's very different to the stuff
One of the things that I teach is you should get yourself into what I call the 50-50 model. So I call it fast pounds. So all of that money that's coming into your success students, I call that fast pounds. So that's income into your personal bank account. And what most people do is spend all their fast pounds. So that could be a salary, fast pounds in. And then the next stage of building wealth is assets, so that's property. Third thing is business, or fourth thing, someone dies or marries, you marry into it. They're the four ways to build wealth: income, assets, number three is business, number four is marry or divorce or death. So they're the way that you can make money. So if you build a fast income, so that's money coming in, good money, you want to make sure that you're investing at least 50% of that back into assets or into business, and then those two parts of wealth fund your fun. You should get all of your fun living holidays coming out of those two things. And really, if you can't invest 50% of your fast pounds coming in, it's working out ways that you can increase that 50-50.
Yeah.
And that's where you're fabulous, because you can teach people how to get that to a 50-50 status.
Yeah, sure.
And if you do that, you're on the path to big wealth.
That's great. James, I really appreciate you coming on to the show.
Yeah.
James Sinclair, check him out.
Thanks, guys.
Where would you recommend people go to that want to check
on my YouTube channel? That's just James Sinclair Entrepreneur. We've got like sort of 300 videos, but they're more business and entrepreneurship. But I really recommend people that are investing into property learn business stuff, read books on business, because there's so much of that stuff that's helped me grow my property business.
Sure.
I think it's the same for you.
Absolutely.
You know, because it is a business that you're running.
You don't want a table with one leg. You want four legs.
Absolutely.
I'm going to put a link to James's YouTube channel below.
Thanks, mate.
So check it out. Subscribe to his channel. James, you're a good friend. Thanks so much for coming on the
show. Thanks, mate. Cheers.